Shame! Shame!
As they wait in River Run's great hall, Catelyn watches her son Rob restlessly adjust his new forged crown several times and remarks to herself that a crown is not easy to wear, especially for a boy of 15 years. The ancient crown of the Kings of Winter was lost 3 centuries ago when Torrhen Stark submitted to Aegon the Conqueror, but the smiths have done well to match the descriptions. An open circlet of hammered bronze surmounted by 9 black iron spikes in the shape of long swords. There is no gold, silver or gems. Bronze and iron are the metals of winter, dark and strong. As the guards bring in the captive, Rob lays down his sword across his knees in the customary gesture of hostility. As Sir Cleos Frey is forced to his knees, Catelyn reflects that he does not look like a Lannister. Although his mother, Lady Jenna, is sister to Lord Tywin Lannister, Sir Cleos has inherited the stringy brown locks, weak chin and thin face of his father, Sir Emon Frey. Rob's sword glimmers faintly as he bids Sir Cleos to rise, but it is Greywind who frightens the knight. As big as any elkhound, Rob's direwolf sniffs at Sir Cleos, who was captured in the Whispering Wood, where Greywind killed 6 men. Sir Cleos scrambles to his feet and away from the direwolf so quickly that it provokes laughter from the audience. Sir Cleos thanks Rob, calling him my lord, but Great John Umber corrects that the king is styled your grace. Sir Cleos accepts the correction, and Catelyn notes that he is truly more Frey than Lannister. He would have never gotten such an honorific out of Jaime Lannister. Rob wishes Sir Cleos to be his envoy to Queen Cersei in King's Landing. Rob reminds Sir Cleos that he considers him a Lannister, not a Frey, since he sided with the Lannisters in the Whispering Wood. He therefore expects Sir Cleos to return with the Queen's reply and resume his captivity. Sir Cleos vows on his knighthood to do so, and asks what the message is. Rob offers to make peace if his terms are met, and at the back of the hall, Lord Rickard Karstark shoves through a rank of guards and out the door, but Rob pays no attention. Exchanging his sword for a parchment, Rob reads his terms. First, the Queen must release his sisters. Second, his father's bones will be returned. Third, his father's sword will be delivered to him at River Run. Fourth, the Queen will command Lord Tywin to release his prisoners. And lastly, King Joffrey and the Queen must renounce all claims to dominion over the North. After a cheer from the Great John, Rob states that he will provide a map of the new borders. He declares that Lord Tywin must cease his raids and withdraw. King Joffrey must rescind all claims to Rob's lands and subjects, and the Lannisters must deliver 10 highborn hostages as a pledge of peace. Rob promises to release 2 hostages every year, so long as the pact is honoured, but if it is not, he will give Queen Cersei another Whispering Wood. To emphasise his point, Rob whistles and Greywind comes forward and snarls. The Great John raises another cheer and Greywind howls. When Sir Cleos agrees, Rob orders him to depart with Sir Robin Ryger at first light and dismisses the assembly. Out in the gallery, Catelyn compliments her son's performance but notes that the theatrics with Greywind befit a boy more than a king. Rob only smiles and asks if she saw Sir Cleos' face. Catelyn replies that what she saw was Rickard Karstark storming out. Rob admits he saw it too. Catelyn's brother Edmure Tully comments that others may agree with Lord Rickard and asks how they can talk of peace while the Lannisters are still pillaging the Riverlands. He urges Rob to march on Lord Tywin at Harrenhal, but Rob insists he does not have the strength. Edmure points out that they only grow weaker sitting here. Catelyn snaps that it was Edmure's idea to permit the Riverlords to depart for their own lands. Edmure argues that he cannot command his lords to remain idle while their crops are burnt and their people killed, but it would be an ill thing if a Northman like Lord Rickard left them. Rob agrees to speak with Lord Rickard, but he cannot blame the man for loathing peace with his son's killers. Catelyn points out that more bloodshed will not bring back the dead. She suggests a wiser man might have offered sweeter terms, but Rob declares that sweeter terms would have gagged him. Catelyn realises that her son wants vengeance as much as Lord Rickard. Catelyn points out that Cersei will never trade Sansa and Arya for a pair of cousins when what she wants is her brother Jaime. Rob explains that his bannermen will never allow him to release the Kingslayer, even if he wanted to. Catelyn says the lords made Rob their king, but Rob replies that they can unmake him just as easy. Catelyn argues that the safe return of the girls is worth Rob's crown, fearing for her daughters if something bad should befall Jaime in their custody. Rob assures her that no one sees Jamie without his warrant. Catelyn asks if Rob is afraid to face Jamie in the field again, and Edmure sides with Rob, but accidentally refers to him as the boy. Rob roars at Edmure not to call him a boy, and declares he can defeat Jamie again if he must. He admits that he would have traded Jamie for his father, but looks hurt when Catelyn presses him to say whether the girls are important enough. Catelyn realises that Rob is doing his best, yet she cannot bear the thought of losing her daughters as well as her husband. Rob promises that if Cersei refuses peace, he will do all he can for his sisters by making her rue the decision. Catelyn can sense Rob is tired of the subject. He asks her to go to the twins to meet Lord Walder Frey's daughters and help choose his future bride. Catelyn sees this as an excuse to send her away for saying things Rob does not want to hear, so she tells Rob he is old enough to choose for himself. Next, Rob urges her to accompany Theon Greyjoy and the Malisters to Seaguard, and return by ship to Winterfell to be with Bran and Rickon. Catelyn insists that until her father dies, her place is at Riverrun. Rob mentions that he could command her to go, but Catelyn counters by asking Rob to reconsider sending Theon as his envoy to Pyke. Rob asks who would be better to negotiate with Lord Balon Greyjoy than his son. Catelyn insists that anyone would be better. Rob argues that Theon fought bravely for them and they have need of his father's longships. Catelyn replies that they will get ships sooner if Theon remains a hostage. She also insists Balon is not trustworthy and may aspire to wear a crown again himself. Rob declares he will gladly give Balon a crown if it helps defeat the Lannisters. Before Catelyn can reply, Rob walks off and Catelyn can only watch him go, remembering back at Moat Cailin when she urged him to command as he does now. Catelyn asks Edmure to join her in her father's sick room, but he begs off to speak with some new recruits. On her way to the central keep, Catelyn shortcuts through the Godswood, where the leaves still rustle on the trees, ignorant of the white raven that has proclaimed the arrival of autumn. Catelyn is thankful that the weather is holding, since autumn is a fearful time, when even the wisest never know if the next harvest will be the last. She finds Lord Hoster Tully sleeping in his solar, made frail by the death growing within him. Beside the beds sits her uncle, Sir Brynden the Blackfish. When Catelyn asks if Rob knows of his return, the Blackfish says he did not interrupt the court because Rob will want to hear his news in private first. When her uncle asks about her father, Catelyn confesses that he grows weaker every day and sometimes his mind is unclear. The Blackfish admits that he always wonders if his brother will be dead upon his return. Catelyn comforts him that at least he made his peace with her father. They sit silently for a long time before Catelyn asks for the Blackfish's tidings. To avoid waking her father, they adjourn to the balcony. Her uncle comments that the Red Comet is now visible by day and says his men call it the Red Messenger, though he wonders what the message is. Catelyn says the Great John claims it is a red flag of vengeance for her husband, while Edmure claims it is a victory omen. A fish in Tully colours, red against blue. Catelyn only sees the crimson of House Lannister, but her uncle points out that the comet is neither Lannister crimson nor Tully red, but a smear of blood across the sky. Catelyn asks whose blood, but the Blackfish asks if there was ever a war when only one side bled. The Blackfish explains that the war has spread south to the Blackwater Rush and north nearly to the Twins. Mark Piper and Carol Vance have won small victories and Beric Dondarrion is harassing Lord Tywin's raiders and foragers. Sir Burton Crakehall boasted killing Dondarrion until Dondarrion killed him in an ambush. Catelyn remembers that some of her husband's household guard rode with Dondarrion from King's Landing and blesses their actions. The Blackfish comments that Dondarrion and Thoros of Myr are clever enough to play hit and run, but Robb should never have permitted the Riverlords return to their own lands. Jonas Bracken was wounded and lost his heir Hendry, claiming Stonehedge. Tytos Blackwood is left with only Raventree Hall, and young Lyman Darry was killed by Gregor Clegane less than a fortnight after reclaiming Castle Darry. The Blackfish declares that Clegane's head would make a noble gift for all the people of the realm. Talk of heads reminds Catelyn that her husband's remains mounted on a spike above the Red Keep. She reminds her uncle that Gregor Clegane is only a servant of Lord Tywin, whom Catelyn believes is the true danger. The Blackfish agrees, noting Tywin's wisdom in sitting safe in Harrenhal and living off their harvests and burning what he does not take. In addition to Clegane, Sir Aemery Lorch and a Cahoric sellsword are also abroad, raping, burning and butchering. Catelyn knows Edmure will rage at the news. She also admits Robb is restless and may listen if Edmure and the Great John will urge him to march on Harrenhal. The Blackfish declares that is exactly what Lord Tywin wishes, and the first rule of war is never to give the enemy his wish. Catelyn recalls the tales of the vast fortress of Harrenhal by the waters of the God's Eye. King Harren the Black beggared the Riverlands and the Ironlands alike to realise his dream of the highest hall and the tallest towers in Westeros, but thick walls and high towers proved small use against Aegon the Conqueror's dragons. Harren and all in his line perished in the fires that engulfed the fortress. Strong the castle might be, but also cursed, for every house that has held Harrenhal since has come to misfortune. Catelyn decides that they must dissuade Robb from fighting at Harrenhal. Her uncle then tells her the worst part. Sir Stafford Lannister is gathering a new host at Casterly Rock, though it will be made of sellswords and new recruits who require training. However, Lord Tywin is in no hurry and will wait patiently for his reinforcements. Then Catelyn gets an idea. If they confront Lord Tywin with a new threat, he might be forced to leave Harrenhal. Her uncle names Lord Renly, but Catelyn insists that they must call him King Renly if they are to ask for his help. The Blackfish smiles, but points out that Renly will want something in return. Catelyn replies that he will want what kings always want. Homage.
I demand a trial by combat.